So welcome to the Hong Kong International Christian Church Sunday service. And the sermon notes have been sent out. If you don't have it, ask your neighbor or the person who invited you up to forward that email to you so you can follow along with all the scriptures. And before we jump into the sermon, I want to share some of the research that I did a couple days ago. I looked into some of the top fears that people have. It doesn't matter who you are, your background. So some of them are, well, the first one is darkness. People are afraid of darkness. And I think especially for me, after watching a scary movie, I mean, I'm like afraid of darkness. I remember 2 weeks ago we watched this movie, Veronica. I couldn't sleep for the next 2 nights. The next thing is heights. People are afraid of heights. Well, last weekend, some of us went to Ocean Park. And you know what? One of the machines is like a drop tower. I remember Candace and I were marching in, like man, like woman and man of God, right? And I looked up, man, that thing is tall. And I turned around for safety purpose. For safety purpose. Public speaking. Well, people are afraid to speak in front of a crowd. Well, spiders. I mean, I don't know why they are afraid of spiders. Snakes. People are afraid of rejections. They don't want to get their feelings hurt. They are afraid of failures. But they don't understand that failure is the beginning to success. And year after year, people didn't continue to do research on what are the top fears. But year after year, there's one thing that's missing on this list. And that's the fear of God.
Wow. Wow.
And the title of today's lesson, Don't You Fear God? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. So we can all agree, nothing is more powerful, more fearful than God. He creates and He destroys. He gives and He takes. Nobody can stand in the way of our God. So why don't people fear Him? Well, point number one, healthy fear. So in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1 to 2, here the Bible says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with His blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. Let's stop here. Well, so in this passage, Christians are called elect and chosen according to God's foreknowledge. Well, people, they might argue, hey, hold on. So God picks and chooses who to be His people. Wow, that's not fair. So some people are destined to go to hell. That ain't right. Well, God, He knows in advance who will and will not accept the gospel because it's outside of time. But however, this knowledge doesn't contradict with the free choice of man. So when you look at Jesus and Judas, Jesus, He knew Judas was going to betray the whole time. But Judas was still responsible for his own action. And well, God, He wants all men to be saved. And that's why He ordered His disciples to go make disciples of all nations. And He uses the gospel as the means of choosing us. Everybody is invited, but few accept the invitation to make Jesus their Lord and Savior. I'll give you a good analogy. It's like when you go to a class, the teacher, he says, hey, certain percentile, you get an A. Certain percentile, you get a B, C, D, etc. So the teacher, he comes up with a plan, but the students, ultimately, they're responsible on what percentile they get at the end. So in a similar manner, God determined the plan, but every single person is responsible to make it to heaven or not. And I remember my first semester in university, first time taking final exams, everybody was like, oh my goodness, the world is ending. I started to study 2 weeks before final exams because I fear failure. And then when I studied the Bible a couple of years later, I had the same fear because I knew I was in sin. And if I didn't get right with God, I'll fail on the final exam on Judgment Day.
Wow.
I got that fear from reading the Bible every single day. And it gave me a sense of urgency to repent. Mm-hmm. And in verse 2 of this passage, it says God's people are to be obedient to Christ. Do we have that fear of failing the final exam on Judgment Day? It's an open book exam, but are you reading it daily? Mm-hmm. Are you praying over it every day? Mm-hmm. And then applying it in your life every single day? Mm-hmm. And the sad truth is, even though it's an open book exam, some people still choose to fail. I remember this brother, he's been around for quite some time. And what happened was her mom passed away a few years ago and she wasn't a disciple. And he said, even after a terrible life and when her mom was on her deathbed, this brother was begging, "Mom, please study the Bible. Please, please, please." But at the end she was like, "No, I'm good. I don't want to follow Jesus." And she passed away. And we all know where she went. And let's continue in verse 3. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time." So here, it says in His great mercy. So God is merciful to us. I think about so many times when I was young, I crossed the street without looking, thinking that nothing could hurt me. And there were so many times I almost got ran over by the big trucks or buses. And then there were times when I hung out with the wrong crowd and I got myself into fights. Probably I could have died in those situations. But God has been merciful to me my whole life. If God has the ability to be merciful to us, that means He also has the ability to punish us. Because when you look, what's mercy? Well, mercy is the kindness you show someone when they deserve punishment. And the religious mindset today has feminized God. Well, Satan, he has deceived the whole world by making us think that, oh, God is soft. He'll never get mad. He lets everyone into heaven because He loves us. It doesn't matter what we do. And I remember right before I became a Christian, I was living with this religious guy. Mm-hmm. And he was going to a Bible school to become a pastor. And the sad thing was, he found this girl online, like a Christian dating website. And then they started dating each other. And I remember there were nights he would bring back this girl home and they would have sex. And I remember there was one time I was like, "Hey bro, but I thought like being a Christian, like you shouldn't be doing this." And he told me, I know it's wrong, but hey, God will understand. He loves me. But you know what? Let's look into the Bible to see how God views it.
Yeah.
Psalm chapter 5. Psalm chapter 5, verse 5 to 6. Here the Bible says, "The arrogant cannot stand in your presence. You hate all who do wrong. You destroy those who tell lies. The bloodthirst and deceitful you, Lord, detest." So this passage is very straightforward. God, He hates all who do wrong. And the reality is God is a warrior. And He stands against unrighteousness. And we need to understand that. And we don't come to church to be entertained. Or maybe right now, some of us, we feel a little bit uncomfortable because of all the stories that I just shared. But maybe we are here today because God is trying to tell us to fear Him.
Wow.
And let's continue, verse 6. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6, the Bible says, "In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. This have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed." Well, nowadays, most people come to church on Sunday to hear a sermon to make them feel good. That's simply not Jesus. And nowadays, it's not popular to preach a sermon that doesn't make people feel good. In fact, people criticize when you preach the truth. Just like how the Jews criticized Jesus. Because the truth hurts. Always. And when you face trials and tough times, God's intention is to prove how genuine our faith is. The disciples in first century were persecuted, they were killed for their faith.
Wow.
Because they knew the gospel is the truth. And now I wanna help us with our perspective when it comes to persecution, standing up for your faith. Well, let's compare some of the disciples in the first century to some of our problems today. Well, maybe our family or friends, they don't like the fact that we need to seek first the kingdom, that we are giving God so much time. They don't like it. You know, the things they say, they make you feel bad. We don't like it. But let's think about Peter. He died for his faith. Peter was crucified upside down. Oh, maybe we don't feel comfortable going out there and talking to people about Jesus. Like, what would they think of me? They would think I'm a crazy, this religious, crazy Christian guy. We want to feel secure. But let's think about Thomas, Apostle Thomas. He went to India to preach the word, and he got speared by soldiers to death. And I remember a couple days ago, Aaron and I, we were sharing on campus. And this atheist, he challenged me. He was like, "Oh, well, show me why the Bible is true, why heaven is real." He did it in a sarcastic way, like he was mocking. And I said, "Well, give me 30 minutes of your time and I can prove it to you." There was no shame of defending the gospel because it's the power of God for the salvation of mankind. Are we ashamed of the gospel? Are we ashamed of the gospel? Are we ashamed to tell people what we do every day for God? Well, let's make another comparison. Well, maybe we want to hold on to our life, God. I want to have the kingdom right here. I want to have my dreams right here. Well, let's look at Matthias, the guy who replaced Judas. He went to Syria, and he was burned alive to death for his faith. We need to reflect on why these people were so radical.
Yeah.
And we also need to reflect on what we are going through right now. It's so tiny compared to what they have to go through. And let's continue in verse 8. "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Why were they so radical? Why were they so radical? Well, because salvation is the best thing someone can ever have in life. That's the great reward for every disciple if they do not give up. And the first century disciples, they feared God. "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." Well, Proverbs 1:7. "Well, even as children, we learn to fear fire and traffic. So we must have a healthy fear of God to keep us in line, to keep us away from sin."
Yeah.
And the fear of God removes all other fears in your life. Maybe you're anxious about your exams, your projects. The fear of God can remove that anxiety. Maybe you're feeling you need a boyfriend or girlfriend to make your life complete. But the fear of God will remove that false feeling.
Yeah.
Because in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing.
Wow.
That's what David says. Or maybe the fear of living a meaningless life. Well, the fear of God will remove that fear of homelessness. Or maybe you fear the shame of what you've done in the past or the mistakes that you'll make in the future. Well, the good news is God's grace is sufficient. God will remove that fear of shame if you let Him. Well, God is here. The question is, are you willing to open up your heart today and let that fear change you? I remember about 2 weeks, I got baptized. I was studying the Bible, and the brothers, they were very hard line with me because I was a very arrogant young man. And I think one of the biggest costs I had to count was I was seeing this girl. Well, she wasn't a disciple, so I couldn't date her if I wanted to become a disciple. And in my mind, I was so fearful. God, what if I never find another girl like her? She's my type. You know, all these things were running around in my mind. But the more I read the Bible, the more I could hear God telling me, she's no good for you. Don't let that fear control you. Instead, let the fear of me, God, change you.
Yeah, come on, Chief.
And every day we should rejoice in the hope of heaven.
Mm.
In the Bible, hope is far more than wishful thinking.
Yeah.
It's made up of both desire and expectation.
Mm.
And our obedience as Christians is motivated by heaven and salvation. And the way we respond to tough times shows us where we put our hope. If our primary motivation for being disciples is to receive all the good things in this lifetime, well, when tough time comes, they will make you really sad. If our hearts are set on things above, we can face any challenge with faith and joy. And faith, like fine gold, is refined by fire.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, all these worldly motivations in us, they cause the fires of trial to consume our faith. And today, are you seeking the face of God, or are you just seeking the blessings that He can give you?
Wow.
Are you seeking the maturity that only tough times can create in you? Or are you just looking to be comfortable at the moment?
Mm.
Are you excited to be with God, or you want something even more, even though you have God? And let's continue. Point number 2, fear creates holiness. 1 Peter chapter 1, continuing in verse 13. Here the Bible says, therefore with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at His coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as He who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy, because I am holy. Since you call on the Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. While holiness is prompted by a hope fully set on heaven, holiness is prompted by not conforming to all these pleasures of this world. And the Hebrew meaning of holy is to be set apart for a special purpose. So disciples of Jesus are to be set apart for the special purpose of God. And while new Christians, they're easy targets for Satan, new Christians, they continue to be tempted with all these attractions in the world.
Yeah.
But none of us, it doesn't matter how long you've been a disciple, none of us ever fully escapes it. It always remains a daily battle in some form.
Yeah.
And we must be obedient children and not conform to the evil desires that we have before. The longer we've been around, the longer we've been tasting how good the Lord is, it's easy to forget what we were like before becoming disciples. We start to think who we used to be actually wasn't that bad. We started to deceive ourselves that, you know what, maybe I can have some of that back in my life. Some of that in my life. And the fear of God keeps us from sinning. When you look at the world, you don't see the fear of God. And that's why it's so messed up. The corruption today makes people think that sin is okay, but it's not. We must remember we are at war with all the evil and satanic powers out there. And growing up, most of us were taught to compare ourselves with others, right? It's never productive. It just creates jealousy, envy, and bitterness in someone's heart. I remember when I was young, around 14, 15 years old, one of my relatives, a really, really close relative, she was comparing me to all these other kids. Oh man, they were getting straight A's. How come you got a B on your report card? All these things. And I didn't get motivated by what she said. Instead, I became very, very bitter in my heart. I just wanted to prove to all these people that they're wrong.
Yeah.
It was so consuming. It's consuming to compare yourself with other people. And it's even more consuming when you try to prove something. But comparing ourselves with God's holiness is always productive. Because it motivates us to become more and more like Jesus Christ without condemnation. Let's continue. Well, let's go to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. Hebrews 12, 14. Here the Bible says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. At going to church once a week, reading your Bible in the morning, all these things alone, they don't make you holy.
No.
They don't make you holy. Being holy means reading the Word of God and applying the principles in your life every single moment of your life.
Okay.
Now that's holiness. And here the scripture says, make every effort. What does that mean? You give 100%.
Yeah.
I remember before I graduated university, I was going crazy. I was like trying to get a job. Because you know, like recession was, back then, 10 years ago, jobs were scarce. You know, competition was really, really high. So I remember I got invited to this job interview. And I heard that 3,000 people applied for it. And they were interviewing 300 people for this one single position. Man, that drives me. I study hard every day. I memorized my resume. I went to like mock interview sessions to learn how to like do good in interviews. And that morning, I went there like an hour early. I practiced my smile, my handshake, in order to get that job. Now that's called make every effort. Well, God is not going to accept lip service. You know, we can say, hey, God, I love you. But neither he demands perfection. Rather, he accepts a heart devoted to him, which leads to a consistent life of making progress, true repentance. And let's go back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. Here the Bible says, for you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him. And so your faith and hope are in God. Christians are redeemed from an empty way of life. Christians are redeemed by the blood of Christ alone. And I want you to take this illustration. We were in the devil's hand before we become Christians.
Yeah.
Like he was playing with you every single day. But God, he redeemed us at a price so high that we don't really grasp it. Mm-hmm. And there's no sin that Jesus cannot forgive. We don't believe in condemning people, but we need to have a true understanding of who is saved and who is lost, in order to have that urgency to go out there every day to seek and save the lost. And not as an act of love. Or maybe you're struggling with sexual sin. Or maybe you've been struggling with a lack of self-esteem, bitterness, being negative, being abused, growing up. And you've been telling yourself that, I was born this way. There's nothing that I can do to overcome it. There's nothing I can do to change it. But here's the good news. If you think you were born that way, the good news is you get born again.
Yeah.
And there's a saying, and I think it applies to the gospel. I owed a debt I could not pay. He, Jesus, paid a debt he did not owe.
Yeah.
And now let's wrap up in verse 22. And here the Bible says, now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. For all people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers, and the flowers fall. But the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you.
Wow.
In this scripture, it says, we obey the truth in order to be purified. If we are not following the word of God, we are not pure.
Mm-hmm.
And we must love one another from the heart. And that's a result of following the truth. And here the command to love one another deeply is from the Greek word agape. The word love here is agape, meaning the unconditional love which describes the very nature of God himself. It tells us to love one another like how God loves us, unconditional. How much do you love the kingdom of God? How much do you love your brothers and sisters? Or do you have your own group of non-Christian friends outside the church that you value more than your brothers and sisters? I did that as a young Christian. And the result, I hurt God and I hurt the brothers and sisters because I was in so much sin. How important is the kingdom of God to you? A lot of people, they say, I was forced into the kingdom. You know, I have to give up everything to come in. Well, the kingdom is not something you sign up for. The kingdom of God is something that you die for.
Mm-hmm.
In conclusion, we talked about don't you fear God.
Mm-hmm.
Having a healthy fear of God will keep us from sinning.
Yeah.
It will give us a sense of urgency to get right with God.
Yeah.
Because we don't want to fail that final exam on judgment day.
Mm-hmm.
I don't. We also talked about the struggles the disciples faced in the first century. And our struggles today, they are so small compared to what they went through. So are we going to let our daily problems be excuses for not fearing God? Are you willing to open up your heart today and let the fear of God change you? Are you excited to be with God, or God isn't enough for you? The fear of God creates holiness in us, and without holiness, no one will see God. And also we talked about how much do you love the disciples, the kingdom of God. And just one last question. Can you stand in front of God today and say, hey God, I truly, truly made every effort to be holy. And if there's any hesitation, any doubt in your heart, it's time to study the Bible and learn how to fear God. And to God be all the glory.